Okay, so let's take a look at how we can use the compositing buffer export filter to render out the individual passes so that we can do post work on them. And the way we do that is we use a filter called compositing buffer export. Okay, so in this scene you can see I've just got a car here and I've got a background. The background's just an image. Hit VPR. And this is pretty much the result. And what we want to do is we want to render out the car and all the different passes and composite them together and tweak them. Okay, so the way we do that is if we go to Window, Image Processing, obviously I've got shortcuts all over the place. In the Processing tab down the bottom we've got Add Image Filter, and if we click on that, up the top we've got Compositing Buffer Export. Okay, and if we double click on that, we get this window. Okay, so this window pretty much allows us to select all the different layers that we want, all the different passes that we want, so that we can composite them all together. Before we get into that, I want to point out a few things in this filter. Basically, if you go over to the Objects tab, make sure that you select the objects that you want to render out, and obviously deselect the ones you don't. Next thing is the subfolders tab. Now the reason for this is if you were, let's say you were doing an animation, and let's say it was a 100 frame animation, if you were to select all your different passes here individually and put them all in one folder, it'd be pretty sort of hard to separate. What this tab does is allows you to select the pass and for the filter to create a folder to put the passes in. In this case I'm only doing a still image, so it doesn't really matter, but if you're doing an animation and you're going to be passing on that information, it's probably wise for it to be in its own folder. Okay, so let's go over to the buffers. So which buffers do we need to render out so that we can recreate the final render that we get here in Lightwave? From this list there's a whole stack of different things, but I pretty much only use about 8 or so, and I found that these 8 are the ones that when put together quite simply recreate the final render. Okay, so starting from the top we'll choose shadow, because we want the shadow pass. With that we can increase or decrease the shadows. Okay, as we go down we want depth. Now the depth is used for blurs and stuff like that, so that we can control where that's happening. If we go down, we don't use any of these others until we get to the shaded section here. Shaded reflections, it gives us our reflection. Shaded diffuse gives us our diffuse. Shaded specular, and we go down to shaded refractions, and the refractions relate to anything that's got glass in it. And lastly, ambient occlusion. Now the ambient occlusion only really renders out when you're using global illumination, otherwise it's just pretty much blank. So that's it. They're the passes that are required to reconstruct this image. Okay, so now let's take a look at some of these options down the bottom here. Now with regards to ambient occlusion options, I pretty much leave mine at the default of infinite, but if you want to change it, you can go ahead and change that. I pretty much leave it as it is. And as well, we've got the depth options. Okay, now this, before I click onto this, I want to show you. I'm just going to wireframe and go to top view. What I've done is I've added a null, and pretty much if I hit the properties for it, under geometry, I've added a custom object of rangefinder. Okay, double click on that and draw a link to the camera. So basically what that tells me is that from any distance from the camera, as I move it around, it gives me the distance as I move the null around. Now in this case I've moved it just there behind the vehicle to just so that it makes life easier to calculate how far the back end of the car is from the camera. And the reason for that is if we go over to depth options, I want to limit the depth, okay? But before I go into that, I want to make sure that you understand that normalized depth to 8-bit, you want to check that so that it creates a 8-bit black and white image for your depth. In this case, I'm going to be rendering out in the PNG with the alpha channel, so it's important to let it know that you just want to create an 8-bit image, okay? And then select limit buffer depth, and I'll set that to about 10 meters. Okay, so our depth options are set. Obviously, if you've got more objects in the scene, well, you can move this around and find out the total depth and do it that way, but obviously there's only the one car in here. So we're pretty much set up in this bottom section. We've had a look at the tabs here. Now let's have a look at the top. Now if you, by default it's set to image viewer, okay? And what that does is, well, I'll show you what that does is, if I've got the my pass is just set to 1, just to keep it simple, go back to the camera and hit, let's have a look at that, and I'll hit render frame. Okay, so that's done, and it with 42 seconds for one pass. So we have our final render that Lightwave creates, and if you look up here in layers, we have all the rest of the layers that we can have a look at, starting off with the shadow, and then we go to depth, and as you can see, the front of the car is dark, and as it gets back towards the car, it gets lighter. So if we were doing some sort of lens blur, we can concentrate the sharpness on the front end of the car. There's our reflection, our diffuse. As you can see, we've got the cars just flat, and in this case it's including the background, but I'll show you how we get around that. There's our specular shading and our refraction. As you can see, the refraction relates to the headlights and a little bit of the glass. Our ambient occlusion, which are our sort of soft shadows, and obviously this is one pass, so it's a bit rough, but gives you an idea. And our final render. Now usually what I do is, once I've rendered it out, I'll save this image as either a JPEG or a PNG, depending on if I want the alpha. What I also do is go over to image and select alpha, and I save that out as well. Now obviously, if this was an animation, if we go to render globals, in your output you would save your RGB, and you would save your alpha as two other passes. So you've got all your composite buffer export passes plus your standard render, your RGB render, and your alpha, okay? So I save this pass out separately. So that's how the image viewing part of compositing buffer export works. Okay, we can close that off. What we want to do is we want to set that to image files, and set that to whatever format we want, in this case PNG32, and then set our file output, and that's basically a folder on your hard drive where all these images will end up. And that is pretty much it. If you're happy with this, you can go ahead and save that out as a preset. But keep in mind, if you save it as a preset and it saves out all these options here, it's also going to save these. So if you've got different objects from a different scene, just make sure you go in and select your objects. So that's how we set up the compositing buffer export. Now, just before we go ahead and hit render, there's a few things I want to do. If I hit the VPR, firstly, I don't want the background, okay? Because I just want the car, I want to isolate the car with all its passes, and I want to composite them over this background, or any background for that matter. So, under the compositing, I'll just close that off. It's still set there. Under the compositing, I'm just going to use black background. Now for the ground, I'm just doing a shift click, VPR shift click. What I've got is, I've just got a shadow catcher set up just for this example, but if I turn that shadow catcher off, I've set it up it's still a shadow catcher, but I've set it up with the black color, and in under advanced I've set it to shadow density. Okay, so you've probably seen me do that before. So what that does is it pretty much, when I render out this scene with compositing buffer export, I'm only getting this car. I'm not getting any backgrounds. I am getting the shadows, and we can take it from there. So it's pretty much set up, ready to go. If it was an animation, you'd put them in their separate folders, and you would render out your alpha passes as well. Now, one more thing that I've done for this example, and I guess you would do it if you had an animation, say you wanted to make some changes to the car body, very specific ones to the car body. What I've done is I've created a separate object. I've duplicated my original object, placed it in a separate layer, and selected the car body and inverted that selection and basically surfaced every other object for this car and set it up so that it's also shadow density and set to black. But when I render this out, where are we? Render globals, render. I've turned off all the shadows, all the reflections, all that kind of stuff, because pretty much all I want to get from it is, I'll just make sure this is off so you can see the result. If I hit render, I want to hit render F9, but the video capture is controlled by that. You can also turn off the radiosity, it's not necessary, but if I hit continue and go to alpha, you'll notice that I've just got an alpha of just the body itself. Now this comes in handy for masking out a little bit later on. It's not completely necessary, but I guess if you were doing an animation and you wanted to make very specific changes to very specific parts, you'd want to render out mats for them. Okay, so I pretty much went ahead and did all that, and these are the results that I got. As you can see, car body mat. This is the ambient occlusions pass. We've got the depth pass. Okay, as you can see, the front of it's darker, and as it gets towards the back, it gets a lot lighter, so we can concentrate and play around with a lens blur or something to that effect. I've also got a raw in here. I was experimenting with that, and basically what I found that if you multiply the raw over the top of the ambient occlusion, you kind of get this diffuse pass. But for this tutorial, I didn't include it, so don't really worry about the raw pass. We're going to be using the shaded diffuse, and so this is the shaded diffuse. As you can see, it's all flat. Next to that, we've got the reflection, we've got the refraction, as I said, relates to anything sort of glass, and we've got the specularity and the shadow, which is inverted. And this is the final Lightwave render with alpha and the final matte. So pretty much, what have we got here? We've got 8, 9, 10, 11 passes that we can use to composite or reconstruct to create our final image, which should look exactly like this when we're done. From that point, I'll show you how we can tweak a few things. So with these passes, we'll move on to Photoshop, and I'll show you how we put it all together. Okay, here we are in Photoshop. Now, to import the files, let me show you a little trick. What this does is it basically imports all the files and layers them on top of each other in no particular order. Anyway, File, Scripts, Load Files into Stack, and you get this window which allows you to browse. If you browse, and we just select them all and hit OK, and then we hit OK, and if you look over here, you'll see it starts importing each of the files and lines them all up rather than placing them in individually, drag and dropping them. It just lines them all up perfectly, but like I said, in no particular order. Okay, so it's done. So what we'll do is we'll just turn them all off, And what I want to do is I want to grab the diffuse and I'll turn that on, and I want to put that right at the top. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically drag the layers underneath it and place them on top in their particular order. Before I do that, I want to grab our background, so I'll just pause and grab that. Let's go ahead now and start basically reconstructing these passes so that we create. Let me turn that on and bring it up the top. That is our final render out of Lightwave, and what we're going to do is we're going to try to reconstruct that. So let's turn that off and I'll just put that back underneath and I'll make that blue. Okay, so we've got our diffuse pass. Okay, and as you can see, it's flat. Now, a really good way to think of this, a good analogy, is think of it as a panel beater, for example, a panel beater who is repairing your vehicle. Now, what they're going to do is they're going to take out all the headlights and all the glass and all that stuff and work on the body separately. And as you can see here, let's just say that this diffuse pass is where the panel beater's painted the underlying or base coat of paint. And usually it's sort of quite dull until it gets cleared and buffed and what have you. But think of the diffuse pass as our base coat for our paint. So once the paint has done that, they go ahead and then they paint over a clear. And the clear usually gives it a bit of shine, but it's not really too reflective. And that clear is our specular pass. So let's grab our specular pass and put it over the top. And we'll turn that on. Okay, and now for the specular reflection and refraction, they all pretty much work on the transfer blending mode of add. Simple as that. You're adding the information that's not black over the top of the diffuse. Okay, so now that we've added a clear gloss, and you can see it's kind of, you know, pretty shiny, but it's still not really reflective. Okay, then the panel beater gets out his buffer and polishes it up, and what we end up is with our reflection pass. So we put that on top. Once again, we're going to select add. Simple as that. We're adding. Okay, and there we have our reflection pass. So we've got our reflections and our specular. So that's a reflection on its own, that's specular on top of the diffuse. This is the order that I use. Okay, and I've experimented a lot and found that this works pretty much the best. Okay, so now that we've got all this, the car's been painted up, panel beater says, well, I better put the headlights and all that back in. So what we'll do is we'll grab our refraction and we'll place that over the top. And once again, we're going to add that. Okay, now you can put the refraction on top of all that, or you can put it directly over the top of the diffuse, but I think with this blending mode, it really doesn't matter because they're just being added. So all three of these, I'll highlight these three and I'll make them green. Okay, so they're adding in no particular order on top of the diffuse, which pretty much gives us our final result. So if I grab our final Lightwave render and put it on top of everything and turn that on, you can see that there's very little difference between Lightwave's render right there and our composite. There's obviously a little bit more transparency going on. In the next bit, I'll go ahead and I'll show you how we can tweak these things. Okay, so now let's take a look at how we can manipulate certain bits and a few Photoshop tricks, I guess, to make some changes. The most obvious ones are obviously we can, you know, decrease any one of these passes so that we can make it less, you know, specular, less reflective. What also we can do is we can play around with the diffuse pass to mess around with the color. Let me just put these back up. Before we go ahead and play around with the diffuse, what we can do also is say we want to increase, obviously we can decrease it by turning the opacity down, but if we want to increase one of these passes, all we need to do is basically select it and hit Control J, and that duplicates it and places it over the top. And as you can see, if I turn it off and on, I've just increased the reflections dramatically, and you can just keep doing that until you're happy. And if it's too much, you can just say I only wanted another half, you can turn that down and you can make it a little bit more reflective. And you can do this with pretty much all of these passes. Okay, so now with the diffuse pass, if we select that, all we can do is we can go in and, well, before we do anything, what I want to do is I want to make use of that car body mat. So I'll go down there and I'll select that car body mat and I'll hit Alt and just sort of isolate that. Okay, so what I can do now is hit Control A and copy that, go over to the channels and make a new layer, and I'm going to paste that in. And the reason I took it out of the layers and copied it into the channels, if I go over to the layers now and I do a control click on it to select that layer, you can see it selects the whole layer. But it, now that it's in the channels, and if I do the same thing, control click on it, it only selects the information that we want. Turn these back on, turn that off, go back to the layers. Okay, so now I can turn that layer back off, and maybe I should have hit, never mind, and we can turn these back on. So now I've got a selection of just the body. That's why I rendered out that pass, so that I can use it as a mask, so that I can isolate the body and make the changes only to the body, as opposed to the whole diffuse pass and then have to, you know, mask bits out. So now that we've got the selection, we select our diffuse pass, we can go over to hue and saturation, and when I click on hue and saturation, you'll notice straight away that this selection will kick in and isolate basically this adjustment layer just to the car body. So if I click that, you can see here on the right hand side of the hue and saturation, the mask is set up for us. And if we shift click, turn it off, it's one of these buttons, left click on it, it isolates our mask. So that's our mask, and it's exactly the same as our mat. Okay, so now that that is done, any changes that we make to the hue and saturation will only affect the car body. For example, if we colorize it and we turn the saturation up, we can now pretty much change the color of our car. It's as simple as that. Okay, so I kind of like this nice blue here. So that's done. Our car body's done. Now, if this was an animation in, say, After Effects or whatever, you could do the exact same and, you know, use the render of the body mat to just isolate and, you know, have the color change throughout the whole animation. So that's one little trick. Okay. Another thing we can do, I guess, with the ambient occlusion pass is we can grab that and we can just place that over the top of the whole lot, or in this case I kind of prefer to just place it over the diffuse because I don't want it to affect any of the spec. And we can turn that on, and if we go to multiply, you'll see that now we've increased the ambient lighting of the whole vehicle. If I turn it off and on, you can see that we've increased the ambience, and we can play around with that and do a stack. The other thing you can do with this particular layer is, I believe if you set it to screen and turn the opacity down, and as you bring the opacity up slightly, it takes away, it subtracts the ambient lighting. Okay, so I'll just turn that off, and I want to show you what we can do with the shadow. Now the shadow works pretty much the same way. If we grab the shadow, I'm going to grab that and I'm just going to place that once again on top underneath our reflections and that kind of stuff. So if we turn our shadow on, you'll notice now that the shadows are white. What we can do with this is, once again, we can select color dodge, and if we turn the opacity all the way down, as we increase it, it should pretty much start to lighten up our shadows. Alternatively, we can just multiply. Sorry, yeah, we multiply, but what we need to do to the shadow pass now to increase the shadows is select that pass and hit Control I, which inverts that pass. And if I isolate it, you'll see that I've inverted it. Now the shadows are black and everything else that is white. And if we then select multiply, this is normal. If we select multiply, now we can increase or decrease our shadows. You can see it's only slightly happening in certain parts of it. But that's pretty much what we can do with the shadow pass. You can use it to increase the shadows, or you can use it to decrease the shadows, as well as the ambient occlusions pass. You can use it to increase the ambience or decrease it. So that's what we do with those two passes, and I'll just make them red. So they're our, now this is our added reflection pass, and we'll just make that green. Okay, so what else have we got down here that we can use? Well, we've talked about the raw. We've got the car body mat. We've got our depth. What we can do with our depth is we can, let's turn that on and isolate the depth. And we can do the same thing we did with the body mat. We can Control A, Control C, go to channels, create a new layer, and paste that in. Now, we're not, stupid keyboard, we're not using this to do any kind of masking, but what we're doing is we're going to use this pass to play around with the lens blur. Now, let me just show you how we can do that real quick. I'm going to just turn that off, and we've pretty much got our channel selected, so we want to turn that off so that we get back to our regular image. Okay, so now we've got this. What we're going to do, before we start manipulating with lens blurs and what have you, once you're sort of happy, what you can do is that you can go to the top most selected layer and hit Control Alt Shift E, and what that does is it creates a final image of what you've done, and then with that you can start manipulating it and playing around with that. Now, we've got this image here, say we're happy with it. Then we want to make use of our depth pass. What we then do is we go to Filter, Blur, Lens Blur, and that brings up this dialog. And if you look over here to the right where it says Depth Matte Source, we want to select our second alpha matte. Well, our, should have renamed it and called it depth, but our second alpha matte was our depth matte. And as you can see now, it's very subtle. Maybe I'll increase it. That's a little bit too much, but you can notice that the back end of the car is blurry, whereas the front, I think I've stuffed it up a bit too much. This is probably a better way to see it. You can see the front end here is all nice and sharp, and as it makes its way towards the back of the car, the back of the car starts to sort of get blurred out. That's what we can use the depth pass for. Now, if you had a whole bunch of objects in this scene, whole stack of cars piled up behind this car, this would come in very, very handy to isolate the foreground object and gradually blur out the background into depth. So that's how we use our depth pass. Okay, so the last thing I want to show you, I think we're pretty much done. Obviously this mat here we can use, once again we can copy that and put that in our channels so that we can use that for cutting out our image. You probably want to go in and just make these sort of opaque areas more solid, but we can use this once again for masking purposes. Last thing I want to show you, and apart from all the other different tweaks that you can do, this next technique is used for two things. One is to create a bit of a light wrap so that we get some of the background kind of, I suppose, reflecting on or wrapping around the edges of our model here of our car to sort of help it blend into the background. Along with that, we're going to duplicate that, and what we can do with that is we can use it to basically lighten up these shadows, because as you can see, these shadows are quite harsh at the moment, and we can use this light wrap technique to sort of dull them down. And the way we do that is that I'm going to have to use our mask here, so I'm going to just turn it on, isolate it, Control A, Control C, go to our channels, make a new layer, Control V, and I'm just going to call that the car. Oops. Okay, deselect. Now we can select that, turn our layers back on, and now you can see that we've got a selection around our car. Now the trick to creating this light wrap is we select our background layer, hit Control J to duplicate it, and with that selection, what that's done, if I bring that up to the topmost and isolate that, what we've done is we've basically cut out the background in the shape of the car. So what we can now do is we can select, control click on that to select it, and if we go to selection, modify, contract, we'll contract it in this case by about 10 pixels. As you can see, it's moved in a little bit. Then we can feather it 5 pixels. So basically we're going 10 pixels in, but we're feathering it 5 pixels towards the outside. And then what we can do is we can either hit delete or hit a mask, invert that mask, or you could have just simply hit delete. If I do that, I can just hit delete and deselect it. Now we've got our light wrap. So what we can do is we can just quickly duplicate that, and I'll turn the bottom one off. So now if we turn all this stuff back on, you'll notice that we get this really obvious light wrap effect around that. But what we can do is we can add a mask to that, and if we hit D, that gives us our default black and white. And you can see if I hit X, it toggles between the two. Select our brush, and with that mask we can go in and we can start removing the light wrap on certain areas, because we want that light wrap just to be along the edge of the vehicle. In this case, not on the shadows, because we'll work on them separately. Maybe I should get a soft brush. Doesn't matter. If I make a mistake, I just hit the X, brings up the white, so it toggles the white, and I can just paint it back in, hit X again, and just sort of fade it off. And now our light wrap is only affecting the edge of the car, and at the moment it's really, really harsh. So what we can do is we can just turn the opacity down until we're sort of happy with it blending in the background, blending over the top or wrapping around the vehicle. Another thing I should have done from the very beginning was select our diffuse shade and go over to layer, matting, defringe, and defringe it 1 pixel, and you can see that it just got rid of that harsh black edge around the outside. Okay, so we've got our light wrap is done, and we can increase it or decrease it. Oops, sorry, wrong layer. We can increase the light wrap or decrease it so that it gives us that nice sort of blend between the foreground and the background. Now with that duplicate that I made of it, if we select that, I'll turn the light wrap off for now. Once again, we'll create a mask. This time I'm going to get rid of all that is over the car. Okay, and I only want it to basically affect our shadow. And as you can see, I haven't done a fantastic job of it, but we can decrease and increase the opacity of that along with our light wrap. Now if we decrease and increase the opacity, you can see that we're lightening up, and well, we're controlling basically the shadow. Okay, so in this case need to pretty much continue to sort of mask out little bits of areas, but these are just, now these might be over the top, you know, exaggerated a little bit, but these are the techniques used to help blend the foreground into the background. Now say once you're happy with that, we've changed the color of it, we've gone and put a bit of effort into our light wraps and what have you, and we're happy with it, then what we can do just to finish it off, and there's just a few things that I like to do. I'm going to go to the topmost layer, once again Control Shift E, and I'm going to create basically a flattened image of all that. I'm just going to turn the rest of them off. And now we can do a few little things just to add to it. These are just my own little sort of personal preferences. Basically what I do is I like to make it a little bit more punchy, so go ahead. Well, what I'll do is I'll right click and convert this to a smart object, and what that does is allows us to add filters to it and tweak them, as opposed to when you add a filter and it's stuck to it. So we'll go over to filter, and I like to hit sharpen, and it just makes it sort of pop out that little bit more. That's without it, and that's with it. It pretty much sharpens it up. Okay, so that's done, and then you have to add the obligatory vignette, and we'll grab our eclipse tool. Okay, invert that, feather it 100 pixels, and just hit the mask, and that gives us a vignette, and we can just dial that down a little bit. One last thing I like to do to the image, second last thing, is I'll go in and filter and add some noise. There we go, so we've pretty much added sharpness, we've added some noise, we've added a vignette, and then on top of all of that we can add, hue and saturation, I'll leave that, and we can add some curves, and the curves we can just sort of crunch it a little bit. We can use the hue and saturation to desaturate it a little bit, and that's pretty much it. So I hope it's helped, and I'll see you next time.